the lesson today. Okay, the next topic, and it would be the last topic of today, that is applications of stack. But it's not actually the last topic, right? Last but not least, because there are so many applications for the stack. I would say that we can use stacks in many, many real-world applications and many problems, right? Because we can also use stack for apply in many applications simply and efficiently. So the topic that we will discuss will be, the first one will be, if you have a list and if you want to reverse the order of the list, what can we do, right? This is also the application for the stack. And we can use stack, right? To implement the reversing of the list easily, right? And the next one is the parenthesis checker. Because we have the open parenthesis and close parenthesis, right? If you want to check for the open, the matching between the pair of the open and closed parenthesis. So you need stack, right? To check for the parenthesis. And the next one is if you want to convert from an infix expression, do you remember infix expression? You can study, you could study about the infix and postfix in discrete math course, right? If you have a multiply by b plus c, right? This is an infix expression. We want to convert into the postfix. It will be a, b multiply and c and plus, right? This is a postfix. Post mean post, right, of the operator, right? Multiplied by and plus sign is operators, okay? And then we can use stack for the conversion of infix to postfix and also to prefix as well. And finally, I will talk about the recursion and the Tower of Hanoi will be the topics about the application of stack. First of all, I would like to start from reversing a list. Like as I just told you, right, if you have a list of ordered or unordered list, right, a list of number can be reversed by reading each number from an array, starting from the first index and pushing it onto the stack. One order, the number has been read, the numbers can be popped one at a time, and then because it is last in, first out, so when you push into the stack, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? When you pop, it will be 4, 3, 2, and 1, right? This is a reversing order, right? This means like this. So we can use stack in order to create the reversing, to reverse a list. Okay, starting from 1, 2, 3, 4, right? When you stack, it will generate 4, 3, 2, 1 by using stack as the temporary storage. And because it is the manner of LIFO, last in, first out, so you can create the reverse order of a list easily. Okay? This is a reverse a list. So if you want to implement the function to reverse a list, so you can simply use the stack, right? You can try to, suppose you implement push and pop already, right? Okay, put this push, this is pop, right? And from this program, right, you allocate array of 10 integer here, and then you scanf get the input, right? The number, if you want to input 5 numbers and then enter the element 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, Okay, scan F, 1, 2, 3, 4, 4, 5, and then push them onto the stack, right? Push them onto the stack and then pop them, right, to array, and then pop them and write it back to an array, right? So you can get the result that is the reverse order of the given list. Okay. So this is an application. So if you want to type whether it is the stack can represent the reversing list, you can just simply write this program. Okay. This is the first application of using stack. The next one, this will be more important and is very useful in a real world application, right? If you want to check for the parentheses, open and close parentheses, right? Stack can be used to check the validity of the parentheses in any algebraic expression. For example, if you have the open, for open bracket like this, and then you should have three closing parentheses as well. Okay, for example, if you have this, right, and this one is not matched to the parentheses, so this we can call it invalid. And if you have expression like this, you have to show that this one is valid. Right, this is the way that we are going to do, right, to check for the parentheses checker. It's not just to check for the parentheses, but also you have to check for the bases as well. Bases, this one is bases, and this one is bracket, okay? Okay, so here we are, we come to the next application, the third one. This is to convert an infix into a postfix expression. For example, if we have a parenthesis A plus B multiplied by C, right? We want to write it in terms of the postfix like this, A, B plus, and then we have to convert this to the postfix first so we can get this, and then we will convert multiply C to C multiply, right? So here we get AB plus C and multiply. Why do we have to change from the infix to postfix expression? Because for the human perception, right, we use infix expression in order to represent the arithmetic expression. For this example, if you want to calculate for 5 plus 2 multiplied by 7, what does it mean? It means that you have to calculate for 5 plus 2 to 7 first and then multiply by 7 so you can get the result that is 49, right? 49. So if you want to evaluate this expression in computer, what you have to do is you have to convert from infix expression into the postfix expression. Why do we have to do that? We have to do that because we want to change from 5 plus 2 multiplied by 7 into 5, 2, and plus, and then 7 and multiply. Why do I have to change this? Because in order to evaluate the arithmetic expression, the first two operands has to be indicated. The first two operands or the two operands has to be indicated, and then operator will be the next. So you can get 5, 2, and plus, it means 7. Right, and then this part of expression will be reduced to or will be evaluated into 7. So here we have 7 and multiply, and this one is operand and operand, and this one is operator. right? So it will be 7 multiplied by 7, and we will evaluate this to be 49. This is the way that computer or the programmer has to write the program in order to, in order to evaluate arithmetic expression like this. So in order to do that, post-fix expression has to be generated. Instead of using infix expression, infix expression is very, it is not suitable form for evaluating the expression. We should use prefix or postfix expression. So stack will be used in this application. Okay. So let's see the example, right? Convert the following infix expression into postfix expressions. If you have a minus b multiplied by c plus d, right? And then you can get a b minus and c d plus. So you have to combine this operand and operand, right? So it will be operand and operand and then operator multiply. So here you can get this one. Do you get the point? Let me explain again. Okay, so from this infix, this is infix expression. So you have to convert this one into postfix. So you can get AB minus, right? And then you can put the braces or the parentheses here in order to make it in a group. And also CD, you can get CD plus and AB minus, right? So you can see these two rectangular. I will represent these two rectangular as two operands. And then multiply will be operator, right? So we have operator will be at last. Operator will be last. Last mean postfix. Post mean last. Right? Postfix. When we say that it is a postfix, right? We will refer to the position that is the last position between two operands. Right, operator will be the postfix, will be the last. So here we can generate the postfix expression as AB minus CD plus and then multiply. For the second case, like A plus B divided by C plus D minus B multiplied by E, right? So we can do the expression inside the parentheses first. This one will convert to this. This one convert to this, and this one convert to this, right? And then this one operator, operand and operand and operator, you can combine them into postfix here, right? And then minus the remaining minus de star or de multiply, right? And then you can continue with DE multiply, right? This one and this one, and then this one is operator. And operator will be put at last. It is postfix. So I hope that you can understand about this one by seeing this example 7.1. I hope that you will understand clearly about the conversion of infix into postfix expression. One thing that you have to consider about the how to convert from infix into postfix expression that is you have to care about the priority of the operator. In arithmetic expression, like we have the priority between plus sign, multiply, divide, and modulo, right? Multiply, divide, and modulo are the highest priority, and three of them are equally priority, right? But the lower priority will be plus and minus, okay? So when you see or when you have to compare which one will be will do first, you will have to do multiply, divide, and modulo first or before plus and minus. Just in case that you don't have the parentheses in order to separate the order of the expression, you have to use priority. In this case, if you have A plus B multiplied by C, oh, this one is a prefix, sorry. Okay, I will talk about the prefix later, right? And then A, this example, A plus B. Will be A, B plus C multiplied. Can you hear the thunder? Okay, this is her postscript, okay? But if you don't have the parentheses, if I have A plus B multiplied by C, what is the postscript of this expression? Anyone, can you help me? If there is a parenthesis, there is no problem. But if you don't have the parenthesis, you have to check for the priority of the operator. BC multiply A plus. That's correct, because we have to check for the priority. So B, C multiply will do first and then A plus will do later. Thank you very much. How about the second one? A minus B multiplied by C plus D. Okay, I remove this or the parentheses out of this expression. What is the postfix of this? Actually, this one, I'm not sure. Should it be A, B, C? I think the correct result should be the orange one. How about the second one? A, B, C. D plus. Right. Why it is like this? Okay, I have to write it in terms of stack. A, B, C, multiply, and plus. When we pop this, right? And then we have to pop two things, right? But when you get this, we have to put this and then C, B. C, B has to be evaluated first and then pop until we have A. Right, so we can have this one. You have to evaluate B, C, B, C, and multiply, right? Multiply, and then you have to when you got multiply, you have to check for the next two operand, that is C and B. When you get C and B, right, you can get the result of B multiplied by C, and this one will be the first operand. And then you have to pop the next operand, the second operand, and then you can evaluate plus and first and the first and the second operand. So this is the way that will be represented in the stack, right? A, B, C, multiply, plus. Okay, so you can have the step of evaluation, that is a B, C will be evaluated first, and then A will be evaluated later. Okay, so this is the example of how to use the stack in order to convert from infix into the postfix expression. And also we can do the same thing for conversion of an infix into the prefix, right? I'm not going into detail, but you have to try to see it, right? To try to understand about this, okay? Okay, and this one is the algorithm that will be used to convert from the infix into postfix expression. Okay. This is another example of how to convert the infix into the postfix expression. So you can see that, right? Once the you scan A first and then minus and then A minus this one. So A, that is the character. So A will be put into the stack. But also in order to, okay, in this way, you have to take care of two things, the operands and operator. You have to take care of this into the stack. And also you have to take care of the parentheses as well. You need parenthesis checker in order to check for the correctness of the parenthesis order. Okay. Once you have A as an input and then minus, okay, A is in the stack. And minus, why minus will be in the stack? And then parenthesis and A is in the stack and B is coming. B, C, B divided by C. So this one will be evaluated, okay? Because match, right? And then we have B. Once we have B and once we have E, right? And you have to pop percent sign. So then you can get the result here. This one is a postfix expression of this one. No. The first one or the second one? The second one is not valid, huh? Invalid. No. 1, 2, 3, 1, 1, and this one. Okay, this is not correct. That there is one more than enough. Right, the closing parenthesis. Okay, I don't want to go into detail about the application, so you can check it out by yourself, and you can just know what is the application of using the stack. Okay, so here we are at the recursion. Do you know recursion? You have already studied about recursion before, right? Both in CVE 100 and also in discrete mathematics. Okay, the recursion function is defined by a function that calls itself. That is called recursive function. Because the function is a function that calls itself to solve the smaller version of its task until the final call is made, which does not require a call to itself. Okay, it will repeat calling itself until there is no call to itself. Okay, since the recursive function repeatedly calls itself, it makes use of the system stack. It will use the operating the system stack. System is means operating system will take care of it to temporarily store the return address and local variable of calling function. This is a way that the recursive function does, right? We can also use stack, right, in order to represent a function A calls function B calls function C, and so on, right? And in more or less, they are the same technique as the recursion, because the recursion function A will call itself, function A will call function A, and function A will call function A until it reaches to the best case, right? So for the recursive function, you need to have the two major cases. The first one is the best case in which the problem is simple enough to solve directly without making any further calls to the same function. Okay, best case will be the stop case. You have to define the stop case for the recursive function first, and then the second cases, or the second case will be the recursive case or inductive step. Sometimes when you study about calculus, a kind of the recursion can be implemented in terms of the math induction. But for CVE 100 or discrete mathematics, right, you can also study about the recursion. Recursion can be divided into two major cases. The first one is a base case, and the second one is a recursive cases. Right? The recursive cases is something like we want to divide the problem into the smaller problem. Some example can be like a factorial. If you want to find 5 factorial, right? 5 factorial can be divided into 5 multiplied by 4 factorial. If you can find the result of 4 factorial, so you can also find the 5 factorial. And for 4 factorial, we can go to 4 multiplied by 3 factorial, right? If you can find 4 factorial, or if you can want to find 4 factorial, you have to find 3 factorial. And then 3 factorial, you have to find 2 factorial, and so on, right? So this is the way that we are trying to solve the problem by using the recursive manner, okay? So can we can go to the example of factorial. Suppose, okay, I have to already write, if we want to find 5 factorial, right? We can write it in terms of 5 multiplied by 4 factorial. But we don't know about 4 factorial as well. So you have to separate it into 4 multiplied by 3 factorial. And 3 factorial, we still don't know about this function as well. So you can extend to 3 multiplied by 2 factorial. And 2 factorial can be 2 multiplied by 1 factorial. And 1 factorial, you can call this as a base case. 1 factorial is equal to 1, right? It cannot be divided furthermore. So you can substitute 1 factorial with 1. This will be 1. So you can get 1 multiplied by 2, 3, 4, and 5. You can get the result. This is the solution. It is 120. This is the result of using the recursive function, factorial function. Can you write a program in order to solve factorial in C program, in C programming? Can you? Okay, this is a program that you can create for the factorial, right? Integer factorial, right? This factorial is a function that will return the integer value. In order to declare it, you have to create the base case first. This one is a base case. If n is equal to 1, so return 1. This is a base case. And we also have to define recursive case as well, right? What does it mean by recursive case? For factorial, right, the recursive case will be n multiplied by n fact. N multiplied by n minus 1 fact. Okay, so you can write by if n is equal to 1, return 1, semicolon, else return parenthesis, right, and semicolon, n multiplied by itself. Itself means that is a factorial function. This is exactly the same as itself function. This is fact n minus 1, and that's all. Okay, this is the way that we are trying to implement factorial function using C programming. Okay, this is the recursion for the recursive function for factorial. So I will go to the next one, that is the greatest common divisor. What does it mean, greatest common divisor? Okay, the greatest common divisor will be the of two numbers or integer, is the largest integer that divides both the numbers, right? The largest integer that can divide both numbers, right? In Thai, we call horomon. Okay, GCD. English is GCD. Okay, so if you want to perform GCD by using recursive function, you can adapt the Euclid's algorithm. What does it mean by Euclid algorithm? For Euclid algorithm, right, GCD will be GCD of A and B will be B. If B can divide A, it means A divided by B is in can be divided. So A modulo B is equal to 0. Otherwise, this is a recursive function. You can find G, C, D of B and A mod B, where A is greater than B. Okay, so this is the Euclid, right, to define the GCD of A and B, two integers. And then we can write the program like this. Okay, before we go to the program, let's assume that A is 62 and B is 8, right? We want to find the GCD of 62 and 8, right? So you have to find the modulo. This one is modulo. Modulo. Modulo means แล้วเอาเศษ okay in this case 62 modulo by 8 right 8 7 is 56 right so we have 6 as the remainder right so 6 is remainder so now here we have okay it's not divisible. So we can go on with B. B will be here and modulo will be here. So GCD 62, GCD 62 and 8 will be equal to GCD 8 and 6, where 6 is a modulo of 62 and 8. And then this one can be modulo, okay, modulo can be, it's equal to 0, right? And then you'll find G, CD of 6 and 2. 6 and 2 is also 0. No, 8 and 6 modulo is 2. So we can continue with 6, 2. And 6, 2 modulo, 6 modulo 2 is 0. So you will return, this is the result. The result is the this one. That is 2, return 2, return 2, and return 2. So GCD of 62 and 8 is equal to 2. So this is the working step of the how to find the GCD in the recursion style. Okay, so here is the C programs for GCD, right? So this is a remainder, EM is a remainder. So if we have X and Y, right? You can find the remainder of X modulo. Y, right? This is the remainder. If remainder is 0, then return Y. What is Y? Y is the second argument. Okay, but if not, you can use Y as the first, and then the remark or a remainder will be the second argument. Okay, this is the recursive step. Okay, this is a recursive step. So when you enter two numbers like 8 and 12, GCD of 8 and 12 will be 4. Okay, this is the second example of recursion. The next example is to find exponent. Exponent is not, okay, it's very easy, right? If you want to find x less to the power y is equal to x multiplied by x less to the power y minus one. Okay, this is very similar to the case of the factorial. So I'm not going into detail about this, but it also can be represented in terms of the step as well. Okay, this is exponential, and this one is also the program, right? Return one when y is equal to 0. X less to the power 0 is equal to 1. This is the fact. But if not, x is equal to exponent like x and less to the power y minus 1. X multiplied by x less to the power y minus 1. This is exponential. exponent. Do you remember Fibonacci series? If you remember Fibonacci series, if you don't remember the Fibonacci series, please press 1. Oh, you still remember Fibonacci? That's good. But I think we have already passed this one. Okay, Fibonacci series will start from 0 and 1, right? And then 0 plus 1 will be equal to 1. 1 plus 1 will be equal to 2. 1 plus 2 is 3. 3 plus 2 is 5. 5 plus 3 is 8. 5 plus 8 is 13, and so on. Right, this is the Fibonacci series, right? So in order to calculate for the Fibonacci, right, if the base case, there are two base cases, right? Two base cases, if n is equal to 0, then return 0. If n is equal to 1, then return 1. Otherwise, return Fibonacci of n minus 1 plus n minus 2. Fibonacci n minus 1 plus n minus 2. Okay, so you can also write the program of Fibonacci like this, but we can have two base cases. N is equal to 0 and n is equal to 1. And then otherwise, right? It will return Fibonacci n minus 1 plus n minus 2. So if you want to find the Fibonacci of an index 5, you can get 3. Okay. No, this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is 4. โอเคค่ะที่บ้านของคารุ่ะบ้านอยู่ไหนคะคณะสอนอยู่ใกล้บ้านกูไหมเนี่ยบ้านกูก็ตกน้ำหนักใช่ไหมของครูบ้านอยู่ปทุมธานีฝั่งปทุมนะคะไม่ได้ฝั่งรังสิตแสดงว่าตกกันหมดเลยเนาะรังสิตตกหนักบ้านกูก็ตกหนักโอเค how about บางมดฝนตกไหมIs it raining at KMUTT Bangmot? Okay, here we are. The last topic of today, and I think it is the most difficult one. That is the Tower of Hanoi. Have you ever studied about Tower of Hanoi? Yes, please press 1. Okay, yes, thank you. So from this heat map, okay. So I will assume that you all understand about the concept of the Tower of Hanoi, right? And Tower of Hanoi is a good example of how to solve, an example of the best of using recursion to solve the problem, right? Because if you solve Tower of Hanoi by using the iterative manner or iterative programming, you may have to keep track on the backtracking of the Tower of Hanoi or the stack. But if you use stack itself by the system, right, it would be easier. Okay, so I hope that you understand about the concept of the Tower of Hanoi. So I will not, or this course is not going to go into detail and explain you about the Tower of Hanoi, but we are going to explain that this one can inside the computer, right? Tower Hanoi, we use the stack in order to implement the recursion. Okay, you know that in order to solve the Tower of Hanoi, right? The best thing you have to do is suppose you have three pegs, right? We have this one we call pegs, and then this one we call stack. Or plate, right? We have three pets, right? So what we have to do is you have to move this one, this pet, stack of pets to this one, to the last pet on last pole, right? But what we have to do is the condition is that the bigger pet, we have to be below the smaller pet. It's not possible to put the smaller pet below the bigger pet. This is a condition of the top for the Tower of Hanoi. So what we have to do is, in order to solve this, you have to move the two one to B. Okay, this is the concept of how to solve the Tower of Hanoi. You have to move this to this, no matter how you do, right? You move this pet to the second pet, and then you have to let this one to the third pet, right? And then you can get this one. And then you have to move this one by using A as a temporary peg, right? And then to move this to here, right? So this is the concept of Tower of Hanoi, right? This also the application of stack. Okay, this is to solve only one plate. This is two plates, right? And this one is three plates, right? This is a step of Tower of Hanoi, right? This is the solution for the Tower of Hanoi. You can, when I went to Hanoi, I have never seen Tower of Hanoi there in this city, but I don't know why, how the name of Tower of Hanoi comes from. Okay, so this is the implementation of the Tower of Hanoi, right? Even it is a puzzle, right? A difficult puzzle, right? That you want to solve on hand or by your hands, right? It's quite difficult, but if you use computer to solve this problem, you can just simply use this piece of code and the result will be very easy to be shown, right? If you write a program like this, and then you can get the result of moving you can follow the step by step of moving the peg or moving the plates from one peg to another peg. Okay, and then that's all for today. Okay, and we have 1 hour. Do you have any questions?